Roundup, glyphosate. Those have become very scary words for some people. Lately, we've been seeing a lot of talk about glyphosate, and there is no shortage of negativity about the subject. I mean, we could talk about the allegations that glyphosate causes cancer. We could talk about it being banned in Brazil. We could talk about the controversy surrounding the IARC's decision to call it a probable carcinogen. Or heck, we could just talk about glyphosate residue in kids' breakfast cereals. We could talk about all of that, and it still wouldn't answer the most important question of all that leads to all these stories. Why do farmers use glyphosate, and why do they fight so hard to be able to keep using it? First, the broad strokes. Glyphosate reduces tilling. Tilling essentially means like turning the soil, loosening it up, and tearing through all the weeds. Tilling is, among other things, basically just weed control. And a huge benefit to using glyphosate with crops that tolerate it is that farmers can adopt minimum or zero till growing systems. They don't need to rip up the dirt for the sake of weeds, they can just spray it. So why no till? Are farmers just like lazy and looking to cut corners? No. Tilling to control weeds is really, really bad for soil erosion. Like all that good topsoil just blows away. Tilling also releases greenhouse gases from the decomposition of organic matter in the soil, and it decreases the overall water holding capacity of the dirt. Why do farmers use glyphosate? Because tilling less is better. That was a simple one. That's done. Easy one out of the way. To get a little deeper into this, we need data, which I have, for two crops in one Canadian province. We're talking corn and soy in Ontario, Canada. So between Return of the Jedi and Frozen, because I measure time in movie releases, the total amount of herbicide used in field corn in Ontario dropped 39% because glyphosate. Glyphosate is applied at a lower rate of active ingredient per acre than the herbicides that it replaced, and total herbicide applied still dropped even though there was an 11% increase in the area of field corn grown. So more corn, but less chemical. Sounds like a win. And in that same 30-year period, the yield of corn increased by 74%, while the use of herbicide per bushel of harvested corn declined by a whopping 70%. So that's like a lot more corn for a lot less chemical. So that was corn, now soybeans. Between Risky Business and The Wolf of Wall Street, the amount of soybeans grown in Ontario increased by 188%. And total herbicide use increased too, but just by 47%. So just like the corn, this is largely due to glyphosate replacing other herbicides, and it did that in spectacular fashion. In terms of all the herbicides used in Ontario, glyphosate went from accounting for 2% of all of it to 82% in that 30-year period. Soybean yield increased by 53% in that same time frame, and the amount of total herbicides applied per bushel produced declined by 67%. So again, the main question, why do farmers use glyphosate? Because using glyphosate means using less chemical overall. But the assumption nowadays is that glyphosate is super bad for you, right? So the next question to get a handle on is, does less chemical overall, but like way more glyphosate overall, actually mean a reduced risk for farmers or consumers? And how would you measure that anyways? We need more data. Luckily, Ontario also publishes a report on the environmental risk associated with the pesticides they use there. Smart. This report uses an environmental impact quotient, an EIQ, to estimate the hazard associated with the use of a given pesticide. An EIQ is basically like an indicator of a pesticide's potential to cause harm. And it's important because once you've determined a pesticide's EIQ, you can compare it with other pesticides to get a sense of the risk of each chemical. Now, there are a few acceptable ways to figure out an EIQ. The one used by Ontario in this report is based on 12 different data points collected by testing pesticides in the lab. Things like short and long-term toxicity in lab animals, half-life, does it leach into runoff? Does it tend to circulate through a plant's tissues? How toxic is it to organisms that it's not meant to affect? Like that kind of stuff. So you run the EIQ for glyphosate and you get 15.3, which is the 10th lowest EIQ of all the pesticides measured in this report. Now compared to other herbicides that it's replaced, like atrazine or metolachlor, is that right? Anyways, glyphosate is just a better choice. Why do farmers use glyphosate? Because the stuff it replaced was worse. But wait, you say. Cancer, you yell. Okay, let's talk about the cancer. So this glyphosate causes cancer thing started with a 2015 report from the International Agency for Research on Cancer, the IARC, which in turn is part of the World Health Organization. So the IARC classified glyphosate as probably carcinogenic to humans, and from there, things got crazy. Glyphosate has kind of been in like a global downward spiral since then. But when you look at this ruling by the IARC, some interesting details begin to emerge that frankly cast a little doubt on it. The IARC report took account of only published toxicity data on glyphosate, even though more data existed, some of which might have changed their ruling. The IARC report also did not include a health risk assessment that would have taken into account how glyphosate is actually used. The alcohol is carcinogenic too, but you can still drink a little bit of it every day and still like live a long, fulfilling life and have grandchildren and all that. So how much glyphosate exposure over time is safe? They never said. Interesting. Also interesting, the IARC had an early draft of this report that contained some findings that didn't fit with their carcinogenic conclusion, so they edited those out. One of my favorite detail, one of the IARC's advisors, Christopher Portier, didn't disclose that he was paid 160 grand by law firms bringing claims by cancer victims against the manufacturers of glyphosate. Like, for example, the law firms who will potentially make millions from that recent $289 million lawsuit against Monsanto. Okay, that's like the scandalous tabloid stuff. On the boring, data-driven side, though, there's more. It's pretty important to understand that the departments that govern glyphosate in a given country have access to like way more data than the IARC does. And besides double-checking published data, these government agencies also look at the huge body of toxicity studies from other countries that use glyphosate too. There's quite a bit of double-checking and confirmation happening across so many countries that if a problem did show up, every country would know about it before the IARC would anyways. Countries also update their information on all the pesticides they use on a really regular basis, like Canada and the USA do so every 15 years. And basically, all of the countries that have reviewed glyphosate recently have reconfirmed its safety in spite of the IARC's findings. So in March 2017, the European Chemicals Agency, yes, that's Europe as in the anti-GMO EU, they said that they didn't find glyphosate to be carcinogenic. In December 2017, the US Environmental Protection Agency released a paper stating that it had reviewed close to 170 epidemiological animal carcinogenicity and genotoxicity studies and that the data didn't support a carcinogenic label for glyphosate. In April 2017, Canada's Pest Management Regulatory Agency released its re-evaluation of glyphosate and said that it's unlikely to pose a human cancer risk. When asked why their findings differed from the IARC's findings, they said the level of human exposure, which determines the actual risk, was not taken into account by the IARC. Now, I'm not a regulatory expert, but it seems as though the IARC has fallen victim to fear-based rhetoric and bad science at best, and like straight-up bribery and altering of evidence at worst. I think I probably need to do a video on this probably carcinogenic thing just on its own. Then again, that probably carcinogenic finding is also key in the recent US $289 million lawsuit against Monsanto that alleges that Roundup caused a man's non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So that's a video too. That lawsuit also fired up the EU's anti-chemical protesters too though, and that had a major impact on the EU's recent decision to ban crops made with CRISPR technology and mutagenesis. God, that needs its own video too. That's a lot of glyphosate talk. But the timing is right for glyphosate talk, which is partially why the Environmental Working Group recently pitted Mothers Against Cheerios with their suspiciously timely study that alleges that there are dangerous levels of glyphosate residue in kids' breakfast cereals. That's a heap and pile of video that I need to make right there. Okay, times are just generally tough for glyphosate. It's getting squeezed all over the world by people who just want to see its use discontinued. But banning glyphosate doesn't make weeds disappear. Banning glyphosate doesn't stop farmers from having to choose something to deal with weeds. So why do farmers use glyphosate? Because it works. Thanks for watching.